Greetings of the day. On behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, College of Engineering, Pune, I welcome you all for the second session for the course Quality Control. In the previous session, we studied about the statistical quality control, need of statistical quality control, the advantages of statistical quality control, and then we started with the data representation approaches which are used in statistical quality control. So we studied how to represent the data using tabular presentation, then how to arrange the data in ascending and descending order, then the frequency distribution, and then the, you know, how to calculate the average from the, you know, tabular form of frequency distribution and so on. So now let us resume the remaining topics of data presentation. The third data presentation is a pie diagram. So a pie diagram represents data in form of circle in which angles at the center are proportional to different components of the total. So it is normally started from a vertical radius to the right of the center of circle and then proceeds in clockwise direction, giving in the ascending order. Considering the example where a lot of 1000 items is procured from 4 suppliers, that is L, M and P, each supplying a different quantity as given here. So if you can see this table, you will find that there are 4 suppliers named N, P, M, L. The quantity supplied by N supplier is 100, by P it is 200, by M it is 300, and by L it is 400. So total quantity supplied by all 4 suppliers is 1000, and if you see the percentage for individual supplier, it for N it is 10%, P it is 20%, M it is 30%, and L it is 40%. Now if you observe this particular table, you will not be able to, you know, to find out the inferences as good as you can find it using a pie diagram. So let us take the example where a pie diagram has been plotted for this particular data. So if you can see, this pie diagram starts with this particular radius, as I already said, which is vertical radius, which is placed in the first quadrant, and then it starts with the lesser percentage, that N has been represented by 10%, then P has been represented by 20%. So we are going by clockwise direction. M has been represented by this 30% in green color, and L has been presented by purple color, which is 40%, and this is how a circle completes. So if you take the summation of all these values, it will be equal to 100. So this is how you can draw this pie diagram for particular data. If you would like to do it in Excel, I'll tell you how to do it. So what we can do is we can select the data, as you can see here. The supplier name and the percentage quantity supplied has been tabulated here. So I will take it through. So you have to select all the cells, go to insert, go to pie, and then just click on the pie diagram. There are many types of pie diagrams are available. You can select the first one. But now you can see the percentage values are missing. So what you can do is you can go to this particular layout and you can select this layout, as this layout is called as layout 6, you can say. So you can enter the name of chart here as pie chart, and you can visualize the percentage of, you know, quantity which is being supplied by the suppliers. So let us move on to the next session. So further, it is learned that a supplier L supplies 200 items with red color, 100 items with green color, 50 with blue, and 50 with yellow color. So another pie chart can be drawn where the quantity being supplied will be represented by some color. The various sectors of the pie diagram can be colored for, you know, better visual impact, we can say, or we can say the aesthetic consideration of the data representation, which is also very important. So if you see the quantity and if you take the percentage, the blue color goods can be considered is in 12.5%. Same for yellow also. Green were for 25% and red for 50%. So again, if you want to plot this using Excel, what you can do is you can just type all the data in the tabular form like this, and you just have to select this two rows with four columns, or we can say the eight cells, go to pie and you can make a pie diagram. So if you see the color also, the color is not shown, so you can change the color by double clicking here, go to fill, say solid fill, and just change the color. So automatically, not automatically, you have to change the color of this particular section. So green is highlighted correctly, but now red has not been highlighted, so go to fill, solid fill, and the red color. See, why I'm telling this, because these all skills are very important when you go to industry and when you want to present your work. Don't think that why I'm telling this all basic things which you can study in MSCIT also. But when you study it in MSCIT, you just study the technique. When you are studying here, you are correlating your technical terms or a data which has been which has to be represented using this kind of diagram, and then you have to draw some inferences out of it. So that is why I'm telling all these things here. So let us move on to the next representation, which is called as bar diagram. So if you can see the graph over here, the year is considered on x-axis, and the respective population is considered on the y-axis. So a bar graph, which is also known as bar chart or bar diagram, is a visual tool that uses bars to compare the data among categories. A bar graph may run horizontally or vertically. The important thing to know is that the longer the bar, the greater the value. So bar graph consists of two axes. One vertical bar graph as shown in this figure, and horizontal axis, that is x-axis, so shows the data categories. For this particular example, they are years. So vertical axis can be considered as a scale, and the colored bars are considered to be a different data series. So the bar graph is considered to have three key attributes or features. The first one is a bar diagram makes it easy to compare sets of the data between different groups at a glance. That means if you take example of machine learning, which we deal regularly for my research work. If I select five different classifiers or algorithms, machine learning algorithms, or we can say supervised algorithm, to classify the data or to predict some value of the data. And if I want to show the accuracy of each particular algorithm, then obviously I'll go for bar diagram, because we have already studied that it can be used to compare the sets of data between the different groups. That means if I want to compare the accuracy of each classifier, then the classifiers will be plotted on x-axis, the names of classifier will be plotted on x-axis, and y-axis the accuracy will be plotted. So just looking at the heights of various classifiers, I'll be able to judge which classifiers gives me more accuracy and which gives the less accuracy. So the second is graph represents the categories on one axis and the discrete value in the other. So I have already told you this. The goal is to show the relationship between two axes. So bar charts also can show a big changes in the data over time. So what is the main difference between the bar graph and the line graph? We will be discussing here. So bar graph display your data in a way that similar to line graphs. Line graphs are they are very useful for displaying the smaller changes over change of the time, whereas Bar graphs are better for comparing the larger changes or differences with the data amongst the groups. So when you have multiple groups and you want to make the difference between the groups, then obviously we will go for plotting a bar graph. So when to use the bar graph? Bar graphs are an effective way to compare items between different groups. This bar graph shows a comparison of numbers on the quarterly basis over 4 year period of time. Users of this chart can compare the data by quarter on year over year trend and also see how the annual sales are distributed throughout each year. So bar graphs are extremely effective visual to use the representation or presentations and the reports. They are popular because they allow the reader to recognize the pattern or trends for more easily than looking at the table of numerical data or values. The most common type of bar graph is the vertical bar graph. So let us try to study types of bar graph. So first is vertical bar graph. It is very useful when presenting a series of data over time. So vertical bar chart, which is shown in this particular figure, shows a series of quarterly data categorized by the year. So now if you can see here, the four quarters, we can say for 2011, 12, 13 and 14 are considered. So when we are considering January, February, March, April, it will be displayed by quarter 1. Then January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August will be displayed by the Q2. September, October, November, we have to consider only 3 months. So January, February, March will be considered as in Q1. April, May, June will be considered as Q2. July, August, September will be considered as Q3. And October, November, December will be considered as Q4. So if you want to find out the how many millions of dollars have been accumulated, or we can say the trend of sales for particular quarter, you can go for comparison with respect to the bar chart. So one disadvantage which we can consider for vertical bar graph is that they don't have leave much room at the bottom of the chart if long labels are required. म्हणजे याचा अर्थ काय आहे, तर इथे जर तुम्हाला लेबल्स द्यायचे असतील, इफ यू वॉन्ट टू लेबल दिस क्वार्टर 1, क्वार्टर 2, क्वार्टर 3, क्वार्टर 4 विथ लॉन्ग कॅरेक्टर्स, देन इट इज इट विल नॉट हॅव मच स्पेस. सो वी विल गो फॉर दी अनदर टाईप विच इज कॉल्ड अ हॉरिझॉन्टल बायोग्राफ. इफ यू सी हियर, नेम्स ऑफ ऑल दिस कंट्रीज हॅव बीन प्लॉटेड ऑर यू कॅन बी डिस्प्लेड हियर. So converting the vertical data into horizontal bar solves this particular problem, which we have discussed as disadvantage of the vertical bar graph. So you can visualize here, there is plenty of rooms for long labels along with the vertical axis are available, and which is shown here. So liters per capita, you can consider any kind of liquid, and the quantity liter per capita has been plotted on this particular axis, which is considered to be the horizontal bar graph. And the fourth type of bar graph is stacked bar graph. You can see here, the stacked bar graph is a visual that can be used to convey the lot of information. Look at the stacked bar graph which is shown here. You can see there are 8 data series which have been highlighted here, which can be considered as the various regions of the world within the each category of year. So 1990 to 2003 is considered as history, and from 2010 to 2030, or we can say 2030, we can consider this as a projection. And on the y-axis, the population is plotted in the millions. So projected international population to 2030 has been plotted, or we can illustrate with respect to this particular bar graph. So if you consider the various data series which are used or which are we used to plot the various regions as Central South America, Africa, Middle East, non-OECD Asia. What is meaning of OECD is that Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. So you know, it is an intergovernment economic organization which includes 37 members as in countries, which was founded in 1961, I guess. So you know, various regions are considered. So trying to show all kind of this data series in a standard bar chart would be very difficult, or it can be impractical. So stacked bar chart in this example allows us to pick out the three important facts. The inferences which has been drawn from this particular stacked bar graph is that the total population is increasing dramatically over the time period displayed. The largest region is the purple segment. If you can visualize it, you know, history of the purple region was very less if you compare the population between 1990 to 2003. But as the year goes from the 2010 to 2030, the population is dramatically increasing. You can, you know, visualize it from this particular colors. So you know, which is also increasing rapidly. And Africa, represented by the gold band second from the top, is clearly the second largest region and has rapidly growing population. If we consider the Africa, which is also shown by this golden color, so we can say it is also dramatically changing. So this is how you know stacked bar chart are considered, or we can consider it for interpreting the various data series with respect to some quantity, or we can say some response. So one of the disadvantages can be discussed about the stacked bar chart is that they may not show a data in a clear manner as intended, and if not read carefully, might even be misleading. For example, in the above chart, the population of Africa increased more than 100% during this time period, while population of non-OECD Asia increased by just 50%. Perhaps lost in this chart is that the population of Middle East also grows by more than 100%. So this point is to make sure that you select the type of graph that best presents the data you want to emphasize upon. So the next is 3D bar chart. So when you want to represent a matrix to interpret some kind of results, then the 3D bar charts are used. So this particular diagram shows a confusion matrix as and the output of machine learning algorithm which are used for classification of the various data series, or we can say classes. If you consider 4N, 3N NSWR, 3N NTCWR, FLWR, CRTWR and so on, these are considered to be the various classes of which we want to we want the categorization. So similarly, the same classes are also plotted along this axis, which are considered as actual classes, and these classes are considered to be the predicted classes. If we consider the total number of samples per class are 50. So if you can see this, if you can see the predicted class and actual class, if you want to compare the union of 4N category for predicted and actual class, it can be seen here. So for 4N category, all 50 samples are correctly classified, so hence they are located at this particular place. If you want to see the union of NSWR with predicted and actual class, it can be seen here as this, this location, which is the diagonal element 2, or the element in the diagonal as which is placed at second row, we can say. So you can see here, out of 50, only 42 samples are correctly classified as this particular class, and 7 are misclassified as this particular class, and 1 is also misclassified with this particular class. So this is not possible using the 2D bar diagrams. So if you want to find out the classification and misclassification, you have to use the 3D graph. So if you consider the diagonal elements, all diagonal elements are considered to be the correctly classified instances. So for third class it is 28 class samples are correctly classified. For fourth class it is 42 samples are correctly classified. For next class it is 44 samples are correctly classified. And for the last class 50 samples are correctly classified. So if you compare, if you observe the samples, row wise samples, you can consider it to be correctly classified samples. And the elements which are placed in non-diagonal, or we can say samples which are placed in non-diagonal elements, are considered to be the incorrectly classified samples. So this is how a 3D bar chart can be employed to interpret the confusion matrix in the machine learning or machine learning approach. Now the last data represented presentation approach is considered to be a frequency histogram. So histogram is nothing but a graphical display of a data using bars of different heights. It is, you can see, it can be similar to bar chart, but a histogram groups the numbers into ranges. So heights of each bar shows how many fall into each range. That means how many quantity fall into each particular range. And then that the range itself will be decided by you or the user. So you can see here, you know, the range is shown as 40 to 50, 50 to 60, 60 to 70, 70 to 80 and so on. And in each range, how many samples, or we can say how many observations are there, can be, you know, displayed on the y-axis. So if you see, we can consider 18 number of samples, suppose, are accumulated in the range of 90 to 100. Like that, we can use the histogram. So now if you take the example of height of orange trees, that we have measured the height of every tree in the centimeters. The height varies from 100 centimeters to 340 centimeters, which we have you know, measured. So now we decide to put the results into groups of 50. So range of range between two measurements will be considered, or the difference between two measurements will be considered as 50. So as to fix the range as 100 to 150, 150 to 200, 200 to 250 and so on. So a tree that is 260 centimeter tall will be added to the range, obviously, which is 250 to 300. So, and the result by plotting this particular data, so what we can do is we will place the range of heights on the x-axis, that is 100 to 150, 150 to 200, 200 to 250, 250 to 300, and 350 to 300 to 350. So now we have to measure the number of trees which falls in the range of 100 to 150. So we can assume that five trees are they are in the range of 100 to 150. Or we can say, you know, it is clearly seen 30 trees are there in the range of 150 to 200. And we can say you know, 50 trees can be seen within the range of 250 and 300. So this is our histogram, which is used for considering how many number of observations falls within the specific range or within the specific category. So now after this, the two videos by my PhD guide will be demonstrated immediately after this particular present slide, which will be able to tell you how to plot histogram using the MS Excel tool, and then how to repeat the same procedure for multiple files to get the number of iterations, and hence that can be used for the data analysis. So I'll play the videos of my PhD guide, Dr. V. Sugumaran from VIT Vellore. I just request all of you to go through these two videos and try to implement all such techniques which we have studied in the second session to analyze the data and try to find out the conclusions. Thank you so much.
And this is a demonstration of how to give a how to create a histogram. say you have 25 values. Suppose you want to draw the histogram like 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. Okay? This is called bin. Okay? You want how many data points lie between 0 and 10, how many between 10 and 20, 20 and 30, like that. So that's called bin you need to create before starting the histogram. You have the data for which you need to create the histogram. Okay? Then what you do is you go to tools and you will find the item called data analysis. Okay? I am giving you a video lecture, so you need not note it down. You can see once again and then note. If you click that, the data analysis has a lot of inbuilt functions. In that one is histogram. Click that, say OK. Here, input range you have to give. Your input range is here, this, from 12 to this 25 data points. And bin range, I told you, you need to select. Automatically it has detected, so it gives this. And you say, if you want a chart output, you say, chart output you can plot as well, and then you say OK. So that your plot will automatically come. So this is the material, histogram for this. This is a demonstration of extracting histogram features from vibration signal. The procedure of forming the bin you should know, and we assume that you have already created a bin. What you see on the screen is the minimum value and the maximum value. In between you have divided that into 10 equal parts and you have 11 bin values. So the bin value is ready and the signal is stored in a particular location. Now we are going to start extracting the histogram features. Open. Before that we have to record this in a macro, so that that can be repeated for 10 files or 100 files, whatever it is. Now for the demonstration sake, we take only 10 files and do it. You can do it for 100 files. Tools, macro, record a new macro. This is histogram file, so I say hist and say OK. Hereafter whatever we do will get recorded. So we open, we go to E, NIMI signal, all files, 1-1, open, next, next, close. Alright, now signal is ready. We need to have the pins. So I go to that Excel file, I copy this pins. Paste special, values alone, okay. I have signal, I have bin value. Now how to compute the histogram feature? Listen carefully. Go to tools, data analysis. You have something called a histogram. Click that. Save okay. You have to give two inputs. One is input range, other one is bin range. Where is your input now? Is lying in first column. Either you can choose all 8192 data, alternately you can choose only that A colon A. That means the A column, whatever is there, because we have not kept anything else in the first column. Similarly, we can choose bin. Since it is only small number of values, I manually select the whole value and then come back. That means bin is available from D1 to D11. Okay. How will it calculate the range, sub-range, from 73.1 to 58.8 is first bin. In fact, if there are lower values, 0 to or anything smaller than minus 73.1 will come. But in this 10 signals, it won't be there. But if at all it is present, it will come. Okay. And this is first range, this is second range. Like that, you have ranges. Manually what we do it, but in computer the first two numbers are considered as first range, second and third is considered as second range, third and fourth is third range, and so on. So you have selected input range and pin range. Now you need to do the say OK. Before that, you say chart output. If you want Excel to plot and show you how does this histogram look like. But here we are not interested in plot. You are leaving it. But in normal case, we are interested in, while we are plotting the histogram, we are interested in plot. So we'll click chart output and then see. Okay. Now I am not clicking purposely because we are interested only in those values. So I say OK. Here we have the bins corresponding to that. How many data points lie on those range of values? Okay. So we have 0, 0, 6, and so on. We can plot. You can plot now this. This plot will give you the histogram. What I do, I take these values, including the values of more, I copy, come to my first Excel file, I store it here, paste special, values only, I transpose it, okay, alright, okay, now I again go back to file 1-1, my all the requirement from this particular file is over, so I close it. Alright. As per, do you want to save? I am not interested. I don't want to waste my memory in the system. So I say no. So for one file, whatever the operation I am supposed to do, I have done it. So the next job is to stop the recording of macro. I go to macro, stop recording the macro. What is the next option? We have to do the necessary modification to repeat the operation for another 9 more times or 10 more times. Tools, macro, macros. Here we have hist, the macro that we have recently stored, say edit. And VB opens up, the program is available. Similar modification, there is no problem except that earlier procedure, everything is same. So shall I do it a little more faster? So for I equal to 2, because 1 we have just now done, 2 to 10. So for I equal to 2 to 10, I have to repeat this operation, the whole operation. So I come to the last statement. Before the last statement, I say next I. Okay. So this has to be repeated. Now, wherever I find the rightmost file name as 1, I replace it with, because first time I want to open the ith file, right? So I say double quotes, space, ampersand, space, I, space, ampersand, space, double quotes. Okay? So now I copy this so that I can paste it wherever I need. Here I have chosen, so here I paste it. Again, C1, yeah, C1 we need to paste because second data should go to the second row. Cth column, second row, third row it should go, ith row basically. So I, again here instead of 1-1 it should be 1-I. Okay. Once you have done this, then save this and say run. Click no, click no, click no, click no, no. No, 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 no. Over, and your histogram features are ready. Now, I have to say stop recording. Procedure is over.